everyone, and welcome to Daily Newspaper Analysis, which is brought to you by Losico. So today we will discuss one article, which is from the Hindu newspaper. The title of this article is The Rising Sun in India-Japan Relations. So this article basically talks about that what can be the prudent expectations that we can draw out of the upcoming meet of India and Japan, and what are the key areas and sectors where both the countries have bilaterally invested. And secondly, we have the News in Flash column. So this analysis is presented by me. My name is Sheva Khan. I have completed my BA LLB Law degree from Law College, Dehradun, Uttaranchal University in the year 2019. I was the gold medalist of my batch, and I have been a national debater and public speaker throughout my educational career. Here at Losico, I'm working as current affairs expert and manager for free content and outreach. If you wish to connect with me, you can join me on Twitter as well as LinkedIn. Both my handles are available in the description box. With this, let's see what is the multiple choice question from yesterday's discussion. Tianhai Space Station module recently seen in news belongs to? Your options are North Korea, China, Taiwan, or Vietnam. If you know the answer, you can put it down in the comment section below. This is the descriptive question for the day. How do you think that Japan as a nation can help build India a stronger position in the Indo-Pacific region? You can write down this answer in a maximum word limit of 250 to 300 words. Also, if you wish to download the PDF of these slides, you can join our Telegram group, the link to which is also available in the description box below. Also, if you like this analysis, please like, share, and subscribe to our channels. On this note, let's get started with the discussion of our article today, which talks about the India and Japan relations. So Japanese Prime Minister Yoshihide Suga's visit to the United States last month is a preview of what India can expect from Japan when the Japanese Prime Minister visits India. Now, as we know that the Prime Minister of Japan, Yoshihide Suga, another thing here we need to note that Yoshihide Suga was only recently appointed as the Prime Minister of Japan. Before Yoshihide Suga, we had Shinzo Abe, who also had played a very, very important role in developing and building stronger the relations between India and Japan. So recently, just in the previous month of April, Yoshihide Suga, the Prime Minister of Japan, had visited the United States, and which actually is good enough to give us a glimpse as to what we as a nation, India, can expect from Japan when in this upcoming meet of India and Japan. So if we talk about this general preview, so we can see the continuation of the balancing security policies against China that began in 2014. Now, if at all we talk about the position of China, keeping in mind both India as well as Japan, so both the countries, India and Japan, have an equitable will to balance the security policy against China, specifically in the Indo-Pacific region. So Mr. Yoshihide Suga has expressed concern over China's unilateral actions in the East and South China Seas, in the Xinjiang province and in the Hong Kong. Now, in our previous discussions as well, we have many times discussed that how China shares boundaries with a lot of countries and with almost all the countries, and even in the waters as well, which are the international waters, China has a claim. And that is why China many a times tries to put up its unilateral actions. Now, what do we mean by unilateral actions? Simply, anything that is done without thinking or without taking any other party into consensus and acting wholly and solely on your own manner or in your own manner or on your own way is acting unilaterally. So similarly, it has been seen lately in the previous years that China has acted unilaterally in the East China Sea, wherein we talk about the islands which are the Senkaku Islands, which are in dispute with Japan and with China. And if we talk about in the South China Sea, then we definitely know about the Spratly and Paracels Island, which are in dispute with the other Southeast Asian nations, and specifically if we talk about it with Philippines. So here, both countries have expanded their high-level ministerial and bureaucratic contacts, conducted joint military pacts like Acquisition and Cross-Servicing Agreement, which is the ACSA. So in these regions, India and Japan both have proactively taken part in various joint military exercises, bureaucratic contacts, and even very high-level ministerial meetings as well. So this continued to work with Quad and support a free and open Indo-Pacific. Now, as we know, when we discuss about the Quad, we have four countries that are the members of Quad. For that matter, we have India, Japan, Australia, and US. And many a times, China thinks that Quad is somewhat like a Pacific, Indo-Pacific NATO, wherein China believes that all these four nations have come together to put down the growth of China. Though, in a way, and theoretically as well, it is no such purpose of the Quad to do so, but still, the presence of these four nations in the Indo-Pacific region definitely deters the unwanted or uncalled for growth of China in the Indo-Pacific region. So if we talk in specific about the technology partnership, both the countries, India and China, will look to expand cooperation in sectors such as cybersecurity and emerging technologies. So during Shinzo Abe, both countries have put together a digital research and innovation partnership, which is artificial intelligence to 5G and Internet of Things. So basically, as we know that Japan as a nation also is very much advanced in technology, and that is why both the countries have enough to give and take in this relation. Next, if we talk particularly about the economic ties and infrastructure development, Japan has invested around $34 billion in the last two decades, but only the 12th largest trading partner of India. Now, even after such huge investment that Japan has done in India, it still remains to be the only 12th largest trading partner of India, as the trading volume is 1/5 of the value of India-China bilateral trade. And yet, as we know that even if we do not have a free trade agreement between India and China, still China stands out in the import and export, and specifically China heavily imports a lot of services and goods to the country India. And if we talk about the third countries wherein both would have invested together, so in the past, both have collaborated. Please don't get confused. We need both. We mean here India and Japan. So both have collaborated to build infrastructure in Iran and Africa and to provide aid to Myanmar and Sri Lanka. So we can see that a good cooperation and a better level of cooperation is being seen between both the nations. And definitely in the coming future, a betterment in these bilateral ties can definitely be expected. With this, let's see what do we have for news and flash today. Soli Sorabji passed away. So the former Attorney General Soli Sorabji passed away at the age of 91 due to COVID-19. So if you talk about Soli Sorabji, he was a Parsi trained at Bombay Law College, a contemporary of others from the Bombay Institution, such as Fali Nariman, Ashok Desai, and Murli Bhandare. He followed the footsteps of his mentor, Nani Palkhiwala, and made significant contributions to the interpretation of constitutional law in independent India. He was a champion of free speech and citizens' liberty, civil liberties, and assisted Palkhiwala in landmark Golaknath and Keshav Nandabharti cases. With this, we are done for the day. We hope it was a good and informative session for you all. Thank you so much for staying tuned with LawSeeko. Please subscribe to our channels for never missing an update in the future.